Besides the offerings, which have been already mentioned, there are many others in various parts of Greece presented by Croesus, as at Thebes in Boeotia, where there's a golden tripod dedicated by him to his Menian Apollo, at Ephesus, where the golden heifers and most of the columns are his gift, and at Delphi in the temple of Pronaia, where there's a huge shield in gold which he gave. All these offerings were still in existence in my day. Many others have perished, among them those which he dedicated at Branchidae in Milesia, equal in weight, as I'm informed, and in all respects like to those at Delphi. The Delphian presents and those sent to Amphiaraus came from his own private property, being the first fruits of the fortune which he inherited from his father. His other offerings came from the riches of an enemy who, before he mounted the throne, headed a party against him with the view of obtaining the crown of Lydia for Pantaleon. This Pantaleon was a son of Aliates, but by a different mother from Croesus, for the mother of Croesus was a Carian woman, but the mother of Pantaleon an Ionian. When, by the appointment of his father, Croesus obtained the kingly dignity, he seized the man who had plotted against him and broke him upon the wheel. His property, which he had previously devoted to the service of the gods, Croesus applied in the way mentioned above. This is all I shall say about his offerings. Lydia, unlike most other countries, scarcely offers any wonders for the historian to describe except the gold dust which is washed down from the range of Tmolus. It has, however, one structure of enormous size, only inferior to the monuments of Egypt and Babylon. This is the tomb of Aliates, the father of Croesus, the base of which is formed of immense blocks of stone, the rest being a vast mound of earth. It was raised by the joint labour of the tradesmen, handicraftsmen, and courtesans of Sardis, and had at the top five stone pillars which remained to my day, with inscriptions cut on them showing how much of the work was done by each class of workpeople. It appeared on measurement that the portion of the courtesans was the largest. The daughters of the common people in Lydia, one and all, pursue this traffic, wishing to collect money for their portions. They continue the practice till they marry and are wont to contract themselves in marriage. The tomb is 6 stades and 2 plethora in circumference. Its breadth is 13 plethora. Close to the tomb is a large lake, which the Lydians say is never dry. They call it the Lake Gygea. The Lydians have very nearly the same customs as the Greeks, with the exception that these last do not prostitute their daughters. So far as we've any knowledge, they were the first nation to introduce the use of gold and silver coin, and the first who sold goods by retail. They claim also the invention of all the games which are common to them with the Greeks. These they declare that they invented about the time when they colonized Tyrrhenia, an event of which they give the following account. In the days of Attis, the son of Manes, there was great scarcity through the whole land of Lydia. For some time the Lydians bore the affliction patiently, but finding that it didn't pass away, they set to work to devise remedies for the evil. Various expedients were discovered by various persons, dice and knuckle bones and ball, and all which games were invented except tables, the invention of which they don't claim as theirs. The plan adopted against the famine was to engage in games one day so entirely as not to feel any craving for food, and the next day to eat and abstain from games. In this way they passed 18 years. Still the affliction continued and even became more grievous, so the king determined to divide the nation in half and to make the 2 portions draw lots, the one to stay, the other to leave the land. He would continue to reign over those whose lot it should be to remain behind. The emigrants should have his son Tyrrhenus for their leader. The lot was cast, and they who had to emigrate went down to Smyrna and built themselves ships, in which, after they had put on board all needful stores, they sailed away in search of new homes and better sustenance. After sailing past many countries, they came to Umbria, where they built cities for themselves and fixed their residence. Their former name of Lydians they laid aside and called themselves after the name of the king's son who led the colony, Tyrrhenians. Thus far I've been engaged in showing how the Lydians were brought under the Persian yoke. The course of my history now compels me to inquire who this Cyrus was by whom the Lydian Empire was destroyed, and by what means the Persians had become the lords paramount of Asia. And herein I shall follow those Persian authorities whose object it appears to be not to magnify the exploits of Cyrus, but to relate the simple truth. I know, besides, three ways in which the story of Cyrus is told, all differing from my own narrative. The Assyrians had held the empire of Upper Asia for the space of 520 years, when the Medes set the example of revolt from their authority. They took arms for the recovery of their freedom, and fought a battle with the Assyrians, in which they behaved with such gallantry as to shake off the yoke of servitude and to become a free people. Upon their success, the other nations also revolted and regained their independence. Thus the nations over that whole extent of country obtained the blessings of self-government, but they fell again under the sway of kings in the manner which I will now relate. There was a certain Mede named Dioses, son of Phraortes, a man of much wisdom, who had conceived the desire of obtaining to himself the sovereign power. In furtherance of his ambition, therefore, he formed and carried into execution the following scheme. As the Medes at that time dwelt in scattered villages without any central authority, and lawlessness in consequence prevailed throughout the land, Dioses, who was already a man of mark in his own village, applied himself with greater zeal and earnestness than ever before to the practice of justice among his fellows. It was his conviction that justice and injustice are engaged in perpetual war with one another. He therefore began this course of conduct, and presently the men of his village, observing his integrity, chose him to be the arbiter of all their disputes. Bent on obtaining the sovereign power, he showed himself an honest and an upright judge, and by these means gained such credit with his fellow citizens as to attract the attention of those who lived in the surrounding villages. They had long been suffering from unjust and oppressive judgments, so that when they heard of the singular uprightness of Dioses and of the equity of his decisions, they joyfully had recourse to him in the various quarrels and suits that arose, until at last they came to put confidence in no one else. The number of complaints brought before him continually increasing, as people learned more and more the fairness of his judgments, Dioses, feeling himself now all important, announced that he did not intend any longer to hear causes, and appeared no more in the seat in which he had been accustomed to sit and administer justice. It didn't square with his interests, he said, to spend the whole day in regulating other men's affairs to the neglect of his own. Hereupon robbery and lawlessness broke out afresh, and prevailed through the country even more than heretofore. Wherefore the Medes assembled from all quarters, and held a consultation on the state of affairs. The speakers, as I think, were chiefly friends of Dioses. "We can't possibly," they said, "go on living in this country if things continue as they now are. Let us therefore set a king over us, that so the land may be well governed and we ourselves may be able to attend to our own affairs and not be forced to quit our country on account of anarchy." The assembly was persuaded by these arguments and resolved to appoint a king. It followed to determine who should be chosen to the office. When this debate began, the claims of Dioses and his praises were at once in every mouth, so that presently all agreed that he should be king. Upon this he required a palace to be built for him, suitable to his rank, and a guard to be given him for his person. the Medes complied, and built him a strong and large palace on a spot which he himself pointed out, and likewise gave him liberty to choose himself a bodyguard from the whole nation. Thus settled upon the throne, he further required them to build a single great city, and disregarding the petty towns in which they had formerly dwelt, make the new capital the object of their chief attention. The Medes were again obedient, and built the city now called Agbatana, the walls of which are of great size and strength, rising in circles one within the other. The plan of the place is that each of the walls should outtop the one beyond it by the battlements. The nature of the ground, which is a gentle hill, favours this arrangement in some degree, but it was mainly effected by art. The number of the circles is seven, the royal palace and the treasuries standing within the last. The circuit of the outer wall is very nearly the same with that of Athens. Of this wall the battlements are white, of the next black, of the third scarlet, of the fourth blue, of the fifth orange. All these are coloured with paint. The two last have their battlements coated respectively with silver and gold. All these fortifications Diosces caused to be raised for himself and his own palace. The people were required to build their buildings outside the circuit of the walls. When the town was finished, he proceeded to arrange the ceremonial. He allowed no one to have direct access to the person of the king, but made all communication pass through the hands of messengers, and forbade the king to be seen by his subjects. He also made it an offence for anyone whatsoever to laugh or spit in the royal presence. This ceremonial, of which he was the first inventor, Diosces established for his own security, fearing that his compeers, who were brought up together with him and were of as good family as he, and no whit inferior to him in manly qualities, if they saw him frequently, would be pained at the sight, and would therefore be likely to conspire against him. Whereas if they didn't see him, they would think him quite a different sort of being from themselves. After completing these arrangements and firmly settling himself upon the throne, Diosces continued to administer justice with the same strictness as before. Causes were stated in writing and sent in to the king, who passed his judgment upon the contents and transmitted his decisions to the parties concerned. Besides which he had spies and eavesdroppers in all parts of his dominions, and if he heard of any act of oppression, he sent for the guilty party and awarded him the punishment meet for his offence. Thus Diosces collected the Medes into a nation, and ruled over them alone. Now these are the tribes of which they consist, the Busai, the Peritachini, the Strucates, the Arizanti, the Budii, and the Magi. Having reigned 53 years, Diosces was at his death succeeded by his son Phraortes. This prince, not satisfied with a dominion which did not extend beyond the single nation of the Medes, began by attacking the Persians, and marching an army into their country, brought them under the Median yoke before any other people. After this success, being now at the head of two nations, both of them powerful, he proceeded to conquer Asia, overrunning province after province. At last he engaged in war with the Assyrians, those Assyrians, I mean, to whom Nineveh belonged, who were formerly the lords of Asia. At present they stood alone by the revolt and desertion of their allies, yet still their internal condition was as flourishing as ever. Phraortes attacked them, but perished in the expedition with the greater part of his army, after having reigned over the Medes 22 years. On the death of Phraortes, his son Cyaxares ascended the throne, Of him it is reported that he was still more warlike than any of his ancestors, and that he was the first who gave organization to an Asiatic army, dividing the troops into companies and forming distinct bodies of the spearmen, the archers, and the cavalry, who, before his time, had been mingled in one mass and confused together. He it was who fought against the Lydians on the occasion when the day was changed suddenly into night, and who brought under his dominion the whole of Asia beyond the Halys. This prince, collecting together all the nations which owned his sway, marched against Nineveh, resolved to avenge his father, and cherishing a hope that he might succeed in taking the town. A battle was fought, in which the Assyrians suffered a defeat, and Cyaxares had already begun the siege of the place, when a numerous horde of Scyths, under their king Medaes, son of Prototaes, burst into Asia in pursuit of the Cimmerians, whom they had driven out of Europe, and entered the Median territory. The distance from the palace Myotis to the river Phasis and the Colchians is 30 days' journey for a lightly equipped traveller. From Colchis to cross into Media doesn't take long. There's only a single intervening nation, the Sasperians, passing whom you find yourself in Media. This, however, was not the road followed by the Scythians, who turned out of the straight course and took the upper route, which is much longer, keeping the Caucasus upon their right. The Scythians, having thus invaded Media, were opposed by the Medes, who gave them battle, but being defeated, lost their empire. The Scythians became masters of Asia. After this, they marched forward with the design of invading Egypt. When they had reached Palestine, however, Psammeticus, the Egyptian king, met them with gifts and prayers and prevailed on them to advance no further. On their return, passing through Ascalon, a city of Syria, the greater part of them went their way without doing any damage, but some few who lagged behind pillaged the temple of celestial Aphrodite. I've inquired and find that the temple at Ascalon is the most ancient of all the temples to this goddess, for the one in Cyprus, as the Cyprians themselves admit, was built in imitation of it, and that in Kythera was erected by the Phoenicians who belonged to this part of Syria. The Scythians who plundered the temple were punished by the goddess with the female sickness, which still attaches to their posterity. They themselves confess that they are afflicted with the disease for this reason, and travellers who visit Syria can see what sort of a disease it is. Those who suffer from it are called Enares. The dominion of the Scythians over Asia lasted 28 years, during which time their insolence and oppression spread ruin on every side. For besides the regular tribute, they exacted from the several nations additional imposts, which they fixed at pleasure. And further, they scoured the country and plundered every one of whatever they could. At length, Cyaxares and the Medes invited the greater part of them to a banquet and made them drunk with wine, after which they were all massacred. The Medes then recovered their empire and had the same extent of dominion as before. They took Nineveh, I will relate how in another history, and conquered all Assyria except the district of Babylonia. After this, Cyaxares died, having reigned over the Medes, if we include the time of the Scythian rule, 40 years. Astyages, the son of Cyaxares, succeeded to the throne. He had a daughter, who was named Mandani, concerning whom he had a wonderful dream. He dreamt that she urinated in such a quantity as not only to fill his capital, but to flood the whole of Asia. This vision he laid before such of the Magi as had the gift of interpreting dreams, who expounded its meaning to him in full, whereat he was greatly terrified. On this account, when his daughter was now of ripe age, he wouldn't give her in marriage to any of the Medes who were of suitable rank, lest the dream should be accomplished. But he married her to a Persian of good family indeed, but of a quiet temper, whom he looked on as much inferior to a Mede of even middle condition. Thus Cambyses, for so was the Persian called, wedded Mandani and took her to his home, after which, in the very first year, Astyages saw another vision. He fancied that a vine grew from the privy parts of his daughter and overshadowed the whole of Asia. After this dream, which he submitted also to the interpreters, he sent to Persia and fetched away Mandani, who was now with child and wasn't far from her time. On her arrival, he set a watch over her, intending to destroy the child to which he should give birth. For the Magian interpreters had expounded the vision to foreshow that the offspring of his daughter would reign over Asia in his stead. To guard against this, Astyages, as soon as Cyrus was born, sent for Harpacus, a man of his own house and of the most faithful of the Medes, to whom he was wont to entrust all his affairs, and addressed him thus, "Harpacus, I beseech thee, neglect not the business with which I am about to charge thee. Neither betray thou the interests of thy lord for others' sake, lest thou bring destruction on thine own head at some future time. Take the child born of Mandani, my daughter, carry him with thee to thy home, and slay him there. Then bury him as thou wilt." "O king," replied the other, "never in time past did Harpacus disoblige thee in anything, and be sure that through all future time he will be careful in nothing to offend. If, therefore, it be thy will that this thing be done, it is for me to serve thee with all diligence." When Harpacus had thus answered, the child was given into his hands, clothed in the garb of death, and he hastened, weeping, to his home. There, on his arrival, he found his wife, to whom he told all that Astyages had said. "What then," said she, "is it now in thy heart to do?" "Not what Astyages requires," he answered. "No, he may be madder and more frantic still than he is now, but I will not be the man to work his will, or lend a helping hand to such a murder as this. Many things forbid my slaying him. In the first place, the boy is my own kith and kin, and next, Astyages is old and has no son. If then, when he dies, the crown should go to his daughter, that daughter whose child he now wishes to slay by my hand, what remains for me but danger of the fearfulest kind? For my own safety, indeed, the child must die, but someone belonging to Astyages must take his life, not I or mine." So saying, he sent off a messenger to fetch a certain Mitridates, one of the herdsmen of Astyages, whose pasturages he knew to be the fittest for his purpose, lying as they did among mountains infested with wild beasts. This man was married to one of the king's female slaves, whose Median name was Spaco, which is in Greek Kino, since in the Median tongue the word Spaca means a bitch. The mountains, on the skirts of which his cattle grazed, lie to the north of Ecbatana, towards the Euxine. That part of Media which borders on the Sasperians is an elevated tract, very mountainous and covered with forests, while the rest of the Median territory is entirely level ground. On the arrival of the herdsman, who came at the hasty summons, Harpacus said to him, "Astyages requires thee to take this child and lay him in the wildest part of the hills, where he will be sure to die speedily. And he bade me tell thee that if thou dost not kill the boy, but anyhow allowest him to escape, he will put thee to the most painful of deaths. I myself am appointed to see the child exposed." The herdsman, on hearing this, took the child in his arms, and went back the way he had come, till he reached the folds. There, providentially, his wife, who had been expecting daily to be put to bed, had just, during the absence of her husband, been delivered of a child. Both the herdsman and his wife were uneasy on each other's account, the former fearful because his wife was so near her time, the woman alarmed because it was a new thing for her husband to be sent for by Harpagus. When, therefore, he came into the house upon his return, his wife, seeing him arrive so unexpectedly, was the first to speak, and begged to know why Harpagus had sent for him in such a hurry. "Wife," said he, "when I got to the town, I saw and heard such things as I would to heaven I had never seen. Such things as I would to heaven had never happened to our masters. Everyone was weeping in Harpagus's house. It quite frightened me, but I went in. The moment I stepped inside, what should I see but a baby, lying on the floor, panting and whimpering and all covered with gold and wrapped in clothes of such beautiful colours. Harpagus saw me and directly ordered me to take the child in my arms and carry him off. And what was I to do with him, think you? Why, to lay him in the mountains where the wild beasts are most plentiful, and he told me it was the king himself that ordered it to be done, and he threatened me with such dreadful things if I failed. So I took the child up in my arms and carried him along. I thought it might be the son of one of the household slaves. I did wonder, certainly, to see the gold and the beautiful baby clothes, and I couldn't think why there was such a weeping in Harpagus's house. Well, very soon, as I came along, I got at the truth. They sent a servant with me to show me the way out of the town and to leave the baby in my hands, and he told me that the child's mother is the king's daughter, Mandani, and his father, Cambyses, the son of Cyrus, and that the king orders him to be killed. And look, here the child is. With this the herdsman uncovered the infant and showed him to his wife, who, when she saw him and observed how fine a child and how beautiful he was, burst into tears, and clinging to the knees of her husband, besought him on no account to expose the babe, to which he answered that it was not possible for him to do otherwise, as Harpagus would be sure to send persons to see and report to him, and he was to suffer a most cruel death if he disobeyed. Failing thus in her first attempt to persuade her husband, the woman spoke a second time, saying, "If then there is no persuading thee, and a child must needs be seen exposed upon the mountains, at least do thus. The child of which I've just been delivered is still born. Take it and lay it on the hills, and let us bring up as our own the child of the daughter of Astyages. So shalt thou not be charged with unfaithfulness to thy lord, nor shall we have managed badly for ourselves. Our dead babe will have a royal funeral, and this living child will not be deprived of life." It seemed to the herdsman that this advice was the best under the circumstances. He therefore followed it without loss of time. The child, which he had intended to put to death, he gave over to his wife, and his own dead child he put in the cradle wherein he had carried the other, clothing it first in all the other's costly attire, and taking it in his arms, he laid it in the wildest place of all the mountain range. When the child had been 3 days exposed, leaving one of his helpers to watch the body, he started off for the city, and going straight to Harpagus's house, declared himself ready to show the corpse of the boy. Harpagus sent certain of his bodyguard, on whom he had the firmest reliance, to view the body for him, and, satisfied with their seeing it, gave orders for the funeral. Thus was the herdsman's child buried, and the other child, who was afterwards known by the name of Cyrus, was taken by the herdsman's wife and brought up under a different name. When the boy was in his 10th year, an accident, which I will now relate, caused it to be discovered who he was. He was at play one day in the village, where the folds of the cattle were, along with the boys of his own age, in the street. The other boys who were playing with him chose the cowherd's son, as he was called, to be their king. He then proceeded to order them about. Some he set to build him houses, others he made his guards. One of them was to be the king's eye. Another had the office of carrying his messages. All had some task or other. Among the boys there was one, the son of Artembares, a Mede of distinction, who refused to do what Cyrus had set him. Cyrus told the other boys to take him into custody, and when his orders were obeyed, he chastised him most severely with the whip. The son of Artembares, as soon as he was let go, full of rage at treatment so little befitting his rank, hastened to the city and complained bitterly to his father of what had been done to him by Cyrus. He didn't, of course, say Cyrus, by which name the boy was not yet known, but called him the son of the king's cowherd. Artembares, in the heat of his passion, went to Astyages, accompanied by his son, and made complaint of the gross injury which had been done him. Pointing to the boy's shoulders, he exclaimed, "Thus, O king, has thy slave, the son of a cowherd, heaped insult upon us." At this sight and these words, Astyages, wishing to avenge the son of Artembares for his father's sake, sent for the cowherd and his boy. When they came together into his presence, fixing his eyes on Cyrus, Astyages said, "Hast thou then the son of so mean a fellow as that dared to behave thus rudely to the son of yonder noble, one of the first in my court?" "My lord," replied the boy, "I only treated him as he deserved. I was chosen king in play by the boys of our village because they thought me the best for it. He himself was one of the boys who chose me. All the others did according to my orders, but he refused and made light of them till at last he got his due reward. If for this I deserve to suffer punishment, here I am ready to submit to it." While the boy was yet speaking, Astyages was struck with a suspicion who he was. He thought he saw something in the character of his face like his own, and there was a nobleness about the answer he had made, besides which his age seemed to tally with the time when his grandchild was exposed. Astonished at all this, Astyages couldn't speak for a while. At last, recovering himself with difficulty and wishing to be quit of Artembares that he might examine the herdsman alone, he said to the former, "I promise thee, Artembares, so to settle this business that neither thou nor thy son shall have any cause to complain." Artembares retired from his presence, and the attendants, at the bidding of the king, led Cyrus into an inner apartment. Astyages, then being left alone with the herdsman, inquired of him where he had got the boy, and who had given him to him, to which he made answer that the lad was his own child, begotten by himself, and that the mother who bore him was still alive, and lived with him in his house. Astyages remarked that he was very ill advised to bring himself into such great trouble, and at the same time signed to his bodyguard to lay hold of him. Then the herdsmen, as they were dragging him to the rack, began at the beginning, and told the whole story exactly as it happened, without concealing anything, ending with entreaties and prayers to the king to grant him forgiveness. Astyages, having got the truth of the matter from the herdsman, was very little further concerned about him, but with Harpagus he was exceedingly enraged. The guards were bidden to summon him into the presence, and on his appearance Astyages asked him, "By what death was it, Harpagus, that thou slewest the child of my daughter whom I gave into thy hands?" Harpagus, seeing the cowherd in the room, did not betake himself to lies, lest he should be confuted and proved false, but replied as follows, "Sire, when thou gavest the child into my hands, I instantly considered with myself how I could contrive to execute thy wishes, and yet, while guiltless of any unfaithfulness towards thee, avoid imbruing my hands in blood which was in truth thy daughter's and thine own. And this was how I contrived it. I sent for this cowherd and gave the child over to him, telling him that by the king's orders it was to be put to death. And in this I told no lie, for thou hadst so commanded. Moreover, when I gave him the child, I enjoined him to lay it somewhere in the wilds of the mountains, and to stay near and watch till it was dead. And I threatened him with all manner of punishment if he failed. Afterwards, when he had done according to all that I commanded him, and the child had died, I sent some of the most trustworthy of my eunuchs, who viewed the body for me, and then I had the child buried. This, sire, is the simple truth, and this is the death by which the child died." Thus Harpagus related the whole story in a plain, straightforward way, upon which Astyages, letting no sign escape him of the anger that he felt, began by repeating to him all that he had just heard from the cowherd, and then concluded with saying, "So, The boy is alive, and it's best as it is, for the child's fate was a great sorrow to me, and the reproaches of my daughter went to my heart. Truly, fortune has played us a good turn in this. Go thou home, then, and send thy son to be with the newcomer, and to-night, as I mean to sacrifice thank-offerings for the child's safety to the gods to whom such honour is due, I look to have thee a guest at the banquet. Harpagus, on hearing this, made obeisance, and went home rejoicing to find that his disobedience had turned out so fortunately, and that, instead of being punished, he was invited to a banquet given in honour of the happy occasion. The moment he reached home, he called for his son, a youth of about 13, the only child of his parents, and bade him go to the palace and do whatever Astyages should direct. Then, in the gladness of his heart, he went to his wife and told her all that had happened. Astyages, meanwhile, took the son of Harpagus and slew him, after which he cut him in pieces and roasted some portions before the fire and boiled others. And when all were duly prepared, he kept them ready for use. The hour for the banquet came, and Harpagus appeared, and with him the other guests, and all sat down to the feast. Astyages and the rest of the guests had joints of meat served up to them, but on the table of Harpagus nothing was placed except the flesh of his own son. This was all put before him, except the hands and feet and head, which were laid by themselves in a covered basket. When Harpagus seemed to have eaten his fill, Astyages called out to him to know how he had enjoyed the repast. On his reply that he had enjoyed it excessively, they whose business it was brought him the basket, in which were the hands and feet and head of his son, and bade him open it and take out what he pleased. Harpagus accordingly uncovered the basket, and saw within it the remains of his son. The sight, however, did not scare him or rob him of his self-possession. Being asked by Astyages if he knew what beast's flesh it was that he had been eating, he answered that he knew very well, and that whatever the king did was agreeable. After this reply, he took with him such morsels of the flesh as were uneaten, and went home, intending, as I conceive, to collect the remains and bury them. Such was the mode in which Astyages punished Harpagus. Afterwards, proceeding to consider what he should do with Cyrus, his grandchild, he sent for the Magi, who formerly interpreted his dream in the way which alarmed him so much, and asked them how they had expounded it. They answered, without varying from what they had said before, that the boy must needs be a king if he grew up and did not die too soon. Then Astyages addressed them thus, "The boy has escaped and lives. He has been brought up in the country, and the lads of the village where he lives have made him their king. All that kings commonly do, he has done. He has had his guards, and his doorkeepers, and his messengers, and all the other usual officers. Tell me, then, to what, think you, does all this tend?" The Magi answered, "If the boy survives, and has ruled as a king without any craft or contrivance, in that case we bid thee cheer up, and feel no more alarm on his account. He will not reign a second time. For we have found even oracles sometimes fulfilled in an unimportant way, and dreams still oftener have wondrously meant accomplishments." "It is what I myself most incline to think," Astyages rejoined. "The boy having been already king, the dream is out, and I have nothing more to fear from him. Nevertheless, take good heed and counsel me the best you can for the safety of my house and your own interests." "Truly," said the Magi in reply, "it very much concerns our interests that thy kingdom be firmly established. For if it went to this boy, it would pass into foreign hands, since he is a Persian, and then we Medes should lose our freedom, and be quite despised by the Persians as being foreigners. But so long as thou, our fellow countryman, art on the throne, all manner of honours are ours, and we are even not without some share in the government. Much reason, therefore, have we to forecast well for thee and for thy sovereignty. If then we saw any cause for present fear, be sure we wouldn't keep it back from thee. But truly we are persuaded that the dream has had its accomplishment in this harmless way, and so our own fears being at rest, we recommend thee to banish thine. As for the boy, our advice is that thou send him away to Persia, to his father and mother. Astyages heard their answer with pleasure, and calling Cyrus into his presence, said to him, My child, I was led to do thee a wrong by a dream which has come to nothing. From that wrong thou wert saved by thy own good fortune. Go now with a light heart to Persia. I will provide thy escort. Go, and when thou gettest to thy journey's end, thou wilt behold thy father and thy mother, quite other people from Mithridates, the cowherd, and his wife. With these words Astyages dismissed his grandchild. On his arrival at the house of Cambyses he was received by his parents, who, when they learnt who he was, embraced him heartily, having always been convinced that he died almost as soon as he was born. So they asked him by what means he had chanced to escape, and he told them how that till lately he had known nothing at all about the matter, but had been mistaken, oh, so widely, and how that he had learnt his history by the way as he came from Media. He had been quite sure that he was the son of the king's cowherd, but on the road the king's escort had told him all the truth, and then he spoke of the cowherd's wife who had brought him up, and filled his whole talk with her praises in all that he had to tell them about himself. It was always Kino. Kino was everything. So it happened that his parents, catching the name at his mouth, and wishing to persuade the Persians that there was a special providence in his preservation, spread the report that Cyrus, when he was exposed, was suckled by a bitch. This was the sole origin of the rumour. Afterwards, when Cyrus grew to manhood and became known as the bravest and most popular of all his compeers, Harpagus, who was bent on revenging himself upon Astyages, began to pay him court by gifts and messages. His own rank was too humble for him to hope to obtain vengeance without some foreign help. When, therefore, he saw Cyrus, whose wrongs were so similar to his own, growing up expressly, as it were, to be the avenger whom he needed, he set to work to procure his support and aid in the matter. He had already paved the way for his designs by persuading severally the great Median nobles, whom the harsh rule of their monarch had offended, that the best plan would be to put Cyrus at their head and dethrone Astyages. These preparations made, Harpagus, being now ready for revolt, was anxious to make known his wishes to Cyrus, who still lived in Persia. But as the roads between Media and Persia were guarded, he had to contrive a means of sending word secretly, which he did in the following way. He took a hare, and cutting open its belly without hurting the fur, he slipped in a letter containing what he wanted to say, and then carefully sewing up the paunch, he gave the hare to one of his most faithful slaves, disguising him as a hunter with nets, and sent him off to Persia to take the game as a present to Cyrus, bidding him tell Cyrus by word of mouth to paunch the animal himself, and let no one be present at the time. All this was done as he wished, and Cyrus, on cutting the hare open, found the letter inside, and read as follows. Son of Cambyses, the gods assuredly watch over thee, or never wouldst thou have passed through thy many wonderful adventures. Now is the time when thou mayst avenge thyself upon Astyages, thy murderer. He willed thy death, remember. To the gods and to me thou owest that thou art still alive. I think thou art not ignorant of what he did to thee, nor of what I suffered at his hands because I committed thee to the cowherd and did not put thee to death. Listen now to me and obey my words, and all the empire of Astyages shall be thine. Raise the standard of revolt in Persia, and then march straight on Media. whether Astyages appoint me to command his forces against thee, or whether he appoint any other of the princes of the Medes, all will go as thou couldst wish. They will be the first to fall away from him, and joining thy side exert themselves to overturn his power. Be sure that on our part all is ready, wherefore do thou thy part, and that speedily. Cyrus, on receiving the tidings contained in this letter, set himself to consider how he might best persuade the Persians to revolt. After much thought, he hit on the following as the most expedient course. He wrote what he thought proper upon a roll, and then, calling an assembly of the Persians, he unfolded the roll and read out of it that Astyages appointed him their general. And now, said he, since it is so, I command you to go and bring each man his reaping hook. With these words he dismissed the assembly. Now the Persian nation is made up of many tribes. Those which Cyrus assembled and persuaded to revolt from the Medes were the principal ones on which all the others are dependent. These are the Pasargadae, the Maraphians, and the Maspians, of whom the Pasargadae are the noblest. The Achaemenidae, from which spring all the Persaid kings, is one of their clans. The rest of the Persian tribes are the following: the Pantheleans, the Derusians, the Gamanians, who are engaged in husbandry, the Daeans, the Mardians, the Dropicans, and the Sagatians, who were nomads. When, in obedience to the orders which they had received, the Persians came with their reaping hooks, Cyrus led them to a tract of ground about 18 or 20 furlongs each way, covered with thorns, and ordered them to clear it before the day was out. They accomplished their task, upon which he issued a second order to them to take the bath the day following, and again come to him. Meanwhile he collected together all his father's flocks, both sheep and goats, and all his oxen, and slaughtered them, and made ready to give an entertainment to the entire Persian army. Wine, too, and bread of the choicest kinds were prepared for the occasion. When the morrow came and the Persians appeared, he bade them recline upon the grass and enjoy themselves. After the feast was over, he requested them to tell him which they liked best, today's work or yesterday's. They answered that the contrast was indeed strong. Yesterday brought them nothing but what was bad, today everything that was good. Cyrus instantly seized on their reply and laid bare his purpose in these words: Ye men of Persia, thus do matters stand with you. If you choose to hearken to my words, you may enjoy these and 10,000 similar delights, and never condescend to any slavish toil. But if you will not hearken, prepare yourselves for unnumbered toils as hard as yesterday's. Now therefore follow my bidding and be free. For myself I feel that I am destined by Providence to undertake your liberation, and you, I am sure, are no whit inferior to the Medes in anything, least of all in bravery. Revolt, therefore, from Astyages without a moment's delay. The Persians, who had long been impatient of the Median dominion, now that they had found a leader, were delighted to shake off the yoke. Meanwhile Astyages, informed of the doings of Cyrus, sent a messenger to summon him to his presence. Cyrus replied, Tell Astyages that I shall appear in his presence sooner than he will like. Astyages, when he received this message, instantly armed all his subjects, and, as if God had deprived him of his senses, appointed Harpagus to be their general, forgetting how greatly he had injured him. So when the two armies met and engaged, only a few of the Medes, who were not in the secret, fought. Others deserted openly to the Persians, while the greater number counterfeited fear and fled. Astyages, on learning the shameful flight and dispersion of his army, broke out into threats against Cyrus, saying, Cyrus shall nevertheless have no reason to rejoice. And directly he seized the Magian interpreters, who had persuaded him to allow Cyrus to escape, and impaled them. After which he armed all the Medes who had remained in the city, both young and old, and leading them against the Persians, fought a battle in which he was utterly defeated, his army being destroyed and he himself falling into the enemy's hands. Harpagus then, seeing him a prisoner, came near and exulted over him with many jibes and jeers. Among other cutting speeches which he made, he alluded to the supper where the flesh of his son was given him to eat, and asked Astyages to answer him now how he enjoyed being a slave instead of a king. Astyages looked in his face and asked him in return why he claimed as his own the achievements of Cyrus. "Because," said Harpagus, "it was my letter which made him revolt, and so I'm entitled to all the credit of the enterprise." Then Astyages declared that in that case he was at once the silliest and the most unjust of men, the silliest if, when it was in his power to put the crown on his own head, as it must assuredly have been if the revolt was entirely his doing, he had placed it on the head of another, the most unjust, if on account of that supper he had brought slavery on the Medes. For supposing that he was obliged to invest another with the kingly power and not retain it himself, yet justice required that a Mede rather than a Persian should receive the dignity. Now, however, the Medes, who had been no parties to the wrong of which he complained, were made slaves instead of lords, and slaves, moreover, of those who till recently had been their subjects. Thus, after a reign of 35 years, Astyages lost his crown, and the Medes, in consequence of his cruelty, were brought under the rule of the Persians. Their empire over the parts of Asia beyond the Halys had lasted 128 years, except during the time when the Scythians had the dominion. Afterwards the Medes repented of their submission and revolted from Darius, but were defeated in battle and again reduced to subjection. Now, however, in the time of Astyages, it was the Persians who under Cyrus revolted from the Medes and became thenceforth the rulers of Asia. Cyrus kept Astyages at his court during the remainder of his life, without doing him any further injury. Such, then, were the circumstances of the birth and bringing up of Cyrus, and such were the steps by which he mounted the throne. It was at a later date that he was attacked by Croesus and overthrew him, as I've related in an earlier portion of this history. The overthrow of Croesus made him master of the whole of Asia. The customs which I know the Persians to observe are the following. They have no images of the gods, no temples, nor altars, and consider the use of them a sign of folly. This comes, I think, from their not believing the gods to have the same nature with men as the Greeks imagine. Their wont, however, is to ascend the summits of the loftiest mountains, and there to offer sacrifice to Zeus, which is the name they give to the whole circuit of the firmament. They likewise offer to the sun and moon, to the earth, to fire, to water, and to the winds. These are the only gods whose worship has come down to them from ancient times. At a later period they began the worship of Urania, which they borrowed from the Arabians and Assyrians. Mylitta is the name by which the Assyrians know this goddess, whom the Arabians call Alitta, and the Persians Mitra. To these gods the Persians offer sacrifice in the following manner. They raise no altar, light no fire, pour no libations. There's no sound of the flute, no putting on of chaplets, no consecrated barley cake. But the man who wishes to sacrifice brings his victim to a spot of ground which is pure from pollution, and there calls upon the name of the god to whom he intends to offer. It's usual to have the turban encircled with a wreath, most commonly of myrtle. The sacrificer isn't allowed to pray for blessings on himself alone, but he prays for the welfare of the king, of the whole Persian people, among whom he is of necessity included. He cuts the victim in pieces, and having boiled the flesh, he lays it out upon the tenderest herbage that he can find, trefoil especially. When all this is ready, one of the magi comes forward and chants a hymn, which they say recounts the origin of the gods. It's not lawful to offer sacrifice unless there's a magus present. After waiting a short time, the sacrificer carries the flesh of the victim away with him and makes whatever use of it he may please. Of all the days in the year, the one which they celebrate most is their birthday. It's customary to have the board furnished on that day with an ampler supply than common. The richer Persians cause an ox, a horse, a camel, and an ass to be baked whole and so served up to them. The poorer classes use instead the smaller kinds of cattle. They eat little solid food, but abundance of dessert, which is set on table a few dishes at a time. This it is which makes them say that the Greeks, when they eat, leave off hungry, having nothing worth mention served up to them after the meats, whereas if they had put more before them, they wouldn't stop eating. They are very fond of wine, and drink it in large quantities. To vomit or obey natural calls in the presence of another is forbidden among them, as such are their customs in these matters. It's also their general practice to deliberate upon affairs of weight when they're drunk, and then on the morrow, when they're sober, the decision to which they came the night before is put before them by the master of the house in which it was made, and if it's then approved of, they act on it. If not, they set it aside. Sometimes, however, they are sober at their first deliberation, but in this case they always reconsider the matter under the influence of wine. When they meet each other in the streets, you may know if the persons meeting are of equal rank by the following token. If they are, instead of speaking, they kiss each other on the lips. In the case where one is a little inferior to the other, the kiss is given on the cheek. Where the difference of rank is great, the inferior prostrates himself upon the ground. Of nations, they honour most their nearest neighbours, whom they esteem next to themselves. Those who live beyond these, they honour in the second degree, and so with the remainder. The further they are removed, the less the esteem in which they hold them. The reason is that they look upon themselves as very greatly superior in all respects to the rest of mankind, regarding others as approaching to excellence in proportion as they dwell nearer to them, whence it comes to pass that those who are the farthest off must be the most degraded of mankind. Under the dominion of the Medes, the several nations of the empire exercised authority over each other in this order. The Medes were lords over all and governed the nations upon their borders, who in their turn governed the states beyond, who likewise bore rule over the nations which adjoined on them. And this is the order which the Persians also follow in their distribution of honour. For that people, like the Medes, has a progressive scale of administration and government. There's no nation which so readily adopts foreign customs as the Persians. Thus they've taken the dress of the Medes, considering it superior to their own, and in war they wear the Egyptian breastplate. As soon as they hear of any luxury, they instantly make it their own, and hence, among other novelties, they've learned pederasty from the Greeks. Each of them has several wives and a still larger number of concubines. Next to prowess in arms, it's regarded as the greatest proof of manly excellence, to be the father of many sons. Every year the king sends rich gifts to the man who can show the largest number, for they hold that number is strength. Their sons are carefully instructed from their fifth to their 20th year in three things alone: to ride, to draw the bow, and to speak the truth. Until their fifth year, they are not allowed to come into the sight of their father, but pass their lives with the women. This is done that if the child die young, the father may not be afflicted by its loss. To my mind, it's a wise rule, as also is the following, that the king shall not put any one to death for a single fault, and that none of the Persians shall visit a single fault in a slave with any extreme penalty, but in every case the services of the offender shall be set against his misdoings, and if the latter be found to outweigh the former, the aggrieved party shall then proceed to punishment. The Persians maintain that never yet did any one kill his own father or mother. But in all such cases, they're quite sure that if matters were sifted to the bottom, it would be found that the child was either a changeling or else the fruit of adultery. For it's not likely, they say, that the real father should perish by the hands of his child. They hold it unlawful to talk of anything which it's unlawful to do. The most disgraceful thing in the world, they think, is to tell a lie. The next worst, to owe a debt, because, among other reasons, the debtor is obliged to tell lies. If a Persian has the leprosy, he's not allowed to enter into a city or to have any dealings with the other Persians. He must, they say, have sinned against the sun. Foreigners attacked by this disorder are forced to leave the country. Even white pigeons are often driven away as guilty of the same offence. They never defile a river with the secretions of their bodies, nor even wash their hands in one, nor will they allow others to do so, as they have a great reverence for rivers. There's another peculiarity which the Persians themselves have never noticed, but which has not escaped my observation. Their names, which are expressive of some bodily or mental excellence, all end with the same letter, the letter which is called Sun by the Dorians and Sigma by the Ionians. Anyone who examines will find that the Persian names, one and all, without exception, end with this letter. Thus much I can declare of the Persians with entire certainty from my own actual knowledge. There is another custom which is spoken of with reserve and not openly concerning their dead. It's said that the body of a male Persian is never buried until it's been torn either by a dog or a bird of prey. That the Magi have this custom is beyond a doubt, for they practice it without any concealment. The dead bodies are covered with wax and then buried in the ground. The Magi are a very peculiar race, different entirely from the Egyptian priests, and indeed from all other men whatsoever. The Egyptian priests make it a point of religion not to kill any live animals except those which they offer in sacrifice. The Magi, on the contrary, kill animals of all kinds with their own hands, excepting dogs and men. They even seem to take a delight in the employment and kill as readily as they do other animals, ants and snakes and such like flying or creeping things. However, since this has always been their custom, let them keep to it. I return to my former narrative. Immediately after the conquest of Lydia by the Persians, the Ionian and Aeolian Greeks sent ambassadors to Cyrus at Sardis, and prayed to become his lieges on the footing which they had occupied under Croesus. Cyrus listened attentively to their proposals and answered them by a fable. There was a certain piper, he said, who was walking one day by the seaside when he espied some fish. So he began to pipe to them, imagining they would come out to him upon the land. But as he found at last that his hope was vain, he took a net, and, enclosing a great draught of fishes, drew them ashore. The fish then began to leap and dance, but the piper said, "Cease your dancing now, as you did not choose to come and dance when I piped to you." Cyrus gave this answer to the Ionians and the Aeolians, because when he urged them by his messengers to revolt from Croesus, they refused. But now, when his work was done, they came to offer their allegiance. It was in anger, therefore, that he made them this reply. The Ionians, on hearing it, set to work to fortify their towns, and held meetings at the Panionium, which were attended by all except the Milesians, with whom Cyrus had concluded a separate treaty, by which he allowed them the terms they had formerly obtained from Croesus. The other Ionians resolved with one accord to send ambassadors to Sparta to implore assistance. Now the Ionians of Asia who meet at the Panionium have built their cities in a region where the air and climate are the most beautiful in the whole world. For no other region is equally blessed with Ionia, neither above it nor below it, nor east nor west of it. For in other countries either the climate is over cold and damp, or else the heat and drought are sorely oppressive. The Ionians don't all speak the same language, but use in different places four different dialects. Towards the south, their first city is Miletus, next to which lie Myus and Priene. All these three are in Caria and have the same dialect. Their cities in Lydia are the following: Ephesus, Colophon, Lebedus, Teos, Cladsomene, and Phocea. The inhabitants of these towns have none of the peculiarities of speech which belong to the three first-named cities, but use a dialect of their own. There remain three other Ionian towns, two situate in isles, namely Samos and Chios, and one upon the mainland, which is Erythrae. Of these, Chios and Erythrae have the same dialect, while Samos possesses a language peculiar to itself. Such are the four varieties of which I spoke. Of the Ionians at this period, one people, the Milesians, were in no danger of attack, as Cyrus had received them into alliance. The islanders also had as yet nothing to fear, since Phoenicia was still independent of Persia, and the Persians themselves were not a seafaring people. The Milesians had separated from the common cause solely on account of the extreme weakness of the Ionians, for feeble as the power of the entire Hellenic race was at that time, of all its tribes the Ionic was by far the feeblest and least esteemed, not possessing a single state of any mark except Athens. The Athenians and most of the other Ionic states over the world went so far in their dislike of the name as actually to lay it aside, and even at the present day the greater number of them seem to me to be ashamed of it. But the 12 cities in Asia have always gloried in the appellation. They gave the temple which they built for themselves the name of the Panionium, and decreed that it shouldn't be open to any of the other Ionic states. No state, however, except Smyrna, has craved admission to it. In the same way, the Dorians of the region, which is now called the Pentapolis, but which was formerly known as the Doric Hexapolis, exclude all their Dorian neighbours from their temple, the Triopium. Nay, they have even gone so far as to shut out from it certain of their own body who were guilty of an offence against the customs of the place. In the games which were anciently celebrated in honour of the Triopian Apollo, the prizes given to the victors were tripods of brass, and the rule was that these tripods should not be carried away from the temple, but should then and there be dedicated to the god. Now a man of Halicarnassus, whose name was Agasicles, being declared victor in the games, in open contempt of the law, took the tripod home to his own house, and there hung it against the wall. As a punishment for this fault, the five other cities, Lindus, Ialissus, Camaerus, Cos, and Cnidus, deprived the sixth city, Halicarnassus, of the right of entering the temple. The Ionians founded 12 cities in Asia, and refused to enlarge the number, on account, as I imagine, of their having been divided into 12 states when they lived in the Peloponnese, just as the Achaeans, who drove them out, are at the present day. The first city of the Achaeans after Sicyon is Palene, next to which are Egyra, Aegae upon the Crathis, a stream which is never dry, and from which the Italian Crathis received its name. Bura, Helice, where the Ionians took refuge on their defeat by the Achaean invaders, Aegium, Ripis, Patrais, Pharaeus, Olenus on the Paris, which is a large river, Dime, and Tritaeis, all seaport towns except the last two, which lie up the country. These are the 12 divisions of what is now Achaea, and was formerly Ionia. And it was owing to their coming from a country so divided that the Ionians, on reaching Asia, founded their 12 states, for it's the height of folly to maintain that these Ionians are more Ionian than the rest, or in any respect better born, since the truth is that no small portion of them were Abantians from Euboea, who are not even Ionians in name, and besides, there were mixed up with the emigration Minii from Orchomenus, Cadmeans, Dryopians, Phocians from the several cities of Phocis, Molossians, Acadian Pelasgi, Dorians from Epidaurus, and many other distinct tribes. Even those who came from the Prytaneum of Athens and reckon themselves the purest Ionians of all brought no wives with them to the new country, but married Carian girls whose fathers they had slain. Hence these women made a law which they bound themselves by an oath to observe, and which they handed down to their daughters after them, that none should ever sit at meat with her husband or call him by his name, because the invaders slew their fathers, their husbands, and their sons, and then forced them to become their wives. It was at Miletus that these events took place. These kings, too, whom they set over them, were either Lycians of the blood of Glaucus, son of Hippolochus, or Pylian Caucons of the blood of Codrus, son of Melanthus, or else from both those families. But since these Ionians set more store by the name than any of the others, let them pass for the pure-bred Ionians, though truly all are Ionians, who have their origin from Athens and keep the Apaturia. This is a festival which all the Ionians celebrate except the Ephesians and the Colophonians, whom a certain act of bloodshed excludes from it. The Panionium is a place in Mycale, facing the north, which was chosen by the common voice of the Ionians and made sacred to Heliconian Poseidon. Mycale itself is a promontory of the mainland, stretching out westward towards Samos, in which the Ionians assemble from all their states to keep the feast of the Panionia. The names of festivals, not only among the Ionians but among all the Greeks, end, like the Persian proper names, in one and the same letter. The above mentioned, then, are the 12 towns of the Ionians. The Iolic cities are the following: Cyme, called also Friconis, Larissa, Neonticus, Temnus, Scylla, Notium, Egyroessa, Pitani, Aegea, Myrina, and Gryneia. These are the 11 ancient cities of the Aeolians. Originally, indeed, they had 12 cities upon the mainland, like the Ionians, but the Ionians deprived them of Smyrna, one of the number. The soil of Aeolis is better than that of Ionia, but the climate is less agreeable. The following is the way in which the loss of Smyrna happened. Certain men of Colophon had been engaged in a sedition there, and being the weaker party, were driven by the others into banishment. The Smyrnaeans received the fugitives, who after a time, watching their opportunity while the inhabitants were celebrating a feast to Dionysus outside the walls, shut to the gates, and so got possession of the town. The Aeolians of the other states came to their aid, and terms were agreed on between the parties, the Ionians consenting to give up all the movables, and the Aeolians making a surrender of the place. The expelled Smyrnaeans were distributed among the other states of the Aeolians, and were everywhere admitted to citizenship. These, then, were all the Aeolic cities upon the mainland, with the exception of those about Mount Ida, which made no part of this confederacy. As for the islands, Lesbos contains 5 cities. Arisba, the 6th, was taken by the Methymnians, their kinsmen, and the inhabitants reduced to slavery. Tenedos contains 1 city, and there is another which is built upon what are called the 100 Isles. The Aeolians of Lesbos and Tenedos, like the Ionian islanders, had at this time nothing to fear. The other Aeolians decided in their common assembly to follow the Ionians, whatever course they should pursue. When the deputies of the Ionians and Aeolians, who had journeyed with all speed to Sparta, reached the city, they chose one of their number, Pithermus, a Phocian, to be their spokesman. In order to draw together as large an audience as possible, he clothed himself in a purple garment, and so attired, stood forth to speak. In a long discourse he besought the Spartans to come to the assistance of his countrymen, but they were not to be persuaded, and voted against sending any succour. The deputies accordingly went their way, while the Lacedaemonians, notwithstanding the refusal which they had given to the prayer of the deputation, dispatched a penteconter to the Asiatic coast, with certain Spartans on board, for the purpose, as I think, of watching Cyrus and Ionia. These men, on their arrival at Phocia, went to Sardis Lacrines, the most distinguished of their number, to prohibit Cyrus, in the name of the Lacedaemonians, from offering molestation to any city of Greece, since they would not allow it. Cyrus is said, on hearing the speech of the herald, to have asked some Greeks who were standing by who these Lacedaemonians were, and what was their number, that they dared to send him such a notice. When he had received their reply, he turned to the Spartan herald and said, "I have never yet been afraid of any men who have a set place in the middle of their city, where they come together to cheat each other and forswear themselves. If I live, the Spartans shall have troubles enough of their own to talk of, without concerning themselves about the Ionians." Cyrus intended these words as a reproach against all the Greeks because of their having marketplaces where they buy and sell, which is a custom unknown to the Persians, who never make purchases in open marts, and indeed have not in their whole country a single marketplace. After this interview, Cyrus quitted Sardis, leaving the city under the charge of Tabalus, a Persian, but appointing Pactius, a native, to collect the treasure belonging to Croesus and the other Lydians, and bring it after him. Cyrus himself proceeded towards Agbetana, carrying Croesus along with him, not regarding the Ionians as important enough to be his immediate object. Larger designs were in his mind. He wished to war in person against Babylon, the Bactrians, the Sacae, and Egypt. He therefore determined to assign to one of his generals the task of conquering the Ionians. No sooner, however, was Cyrus gone from Sardis than Pactius induced his countrymen to rise in open revolt against him and his deputy Tabalus. With the vast treasures at his disposal, he then went down to the sea and employed them in hiring mercenary troops, while at the same time he engaged the people of the coast to enroll themselves in his army. He then marched upon Sardis, where he besieged Tabalus, who shut himself up in the citadel. When Cyrus, on his way to Agbetana, received these tidings, he turned to Croesus and said, "Where will all this end, Croesus, thinkest thou? It seemeth that these Lydians will not cease to cause trouble both to themselves and others. I doubt me if it were not best to sell them all for slaves. Methinks what I have now done is as if a man were to kill the father and then spare the child. Thou who wert something more than a father to thy people, I have seized and carried off, and to that people I have entrusted their city. Can I then feel surprise at their rebellion?" Thus did Cyrus open to Croesus his thoughts, whereat the latter, full of alarm lest Cyrus should lay Sardis in ruins, replied as follows: "O my king, thy words are reasonable, but do not, I beseech thee, give full vent to thy anger, nor doom to destruction an ancient city, guiltless alike of the past and of the present trouble. I caused the one, and in my own person now pay the forfeit. Pactius has caused the other, he to whom thou gavest Sardis in charge. Let him bear the punishment. Grant then forgiveness to the Lydians, and to make sure of their never rebelling against thee or alarming thee more, send and forbid them to keep any weapons of war, command them to wear tunics under their cloaks, and to put buskins upon their legs, and make them bring up their sons to kithern playing, harping, and shopkeeping. So wilt thou soon see them become women instead of men, and there will be no more fear of their revolting from thee." Croesus thought the Lydians would even so be better off than if they were sold for slaves, and therefore gave the above advice to Sardis, knowing that unless he brought forward some notable suggestion, he wouldn't be able to persuade him to alter his mind. He was likewise afraid lest, after escaping the danger which now pressed, the Lydians at some future time might revolt from the Persians, and so bring themselves to ruin. The advice pleased Cyrus, who consented to forego his anger and do as Croesus had said. Thereupon he summoned to his presence a certain Mede, Mazares by name, and charged him to issue orders to the Lydians in accordance with the terms of Croesus's discourse. Further, he commanded him to sell for slaves all who had joined the Lydians in their attack upon Sardis, and above aught else to be sure that he brought Pactias with him alive on his return. Having given these orders, Cyrus continued his journey towards the Persian territory. Pactias, when news came of the near approach of the army sent against him, fled in terror to Chaime. Mazares, therefore, the Median general who had marched on Sardis with a detachment of the army of Cyrus, finding in his arrival that Pactias and his troops were gone, immediately entered the town. And first of all he forced the Lydians to obey the orders of his master and change, as they did from that time, their entire manner of living. Next he dispatched messengers to Chaime and required to have Pactias delivered up to him. On this the Chaimeans resolved to send to Branchidae and ask the advice of the god. Branchidae is situated in the territory of Miletus, above the port of Panormus. There was an oracle there, established in very ancient times, which both the Ionians and Aeolians were wont often to consult. Hither, therefore, the Chaimeans sent their deputies to make inquiry at the shrine what the gods would like them to do with the Lydian Pactias. The oracle told them, in reply, to give him up to the Persians. With this answer the messengers returned, and the people of Chaime were ready to surrender him accordingly. But as they were preparing to do so, Aristodicus, son of Heraclides, a citizen of distinction, hindered them. He declared that he distrusted the response and believed that the messengers had reported it falsely, until at last another embassy, of which Aristodicus himself made part, was dispatched to repeat the former inquiry concerning Pactias. On their arrival at the shrine of the god, Aristodicus, speaking on behalf of the whole body, thus addressed the oracle. O king, Pactias the Lydian, threatened by the Persians with a violent death, has come to us for sanctuary, and lo, they ask him at our hands, calling upon our nation to deliver him up. Now though we greatly dread the Persian power, yet have we not been bold to give up our suppliant till we have certain knowledge of thy mind what thou wouldst have us to do. The oracle thus questioned gave the same answer as before, bidding them surrender Pactias to the Persians. Whereupon Aristodicus, who had come prepared for such an answer, proceeded to make the circuit of the temple and to take all the nests of young sparrows and other birds that he could find about the building. As he was thus employed, a voice, it said, came forth from the inner sanctuary, addressing Aristodicus in these words, "Most impious of men, what is this thou hast the face to do? Dost thou tear my suppliants from my temple?" Aristodicus, at no loss for a reply, rejoined, "O king, art thou so ready to protect thy suppliants, and dost thou command the Chaimeans to give up a suppliant?" "Yes," returned the god, "I do command it, that so for the impiety you may the sooner perish and not come here again to consult my oracle about the surrender of suppliants." On the receipt of this answer, the Chaimeans, unwilling to bring the threatened destruction on themselves by giving up the man, and afraid of having to endure a siege if they continued to harbour him, sent Pactias away to Mitylene. On this, Mazares dispatched envoys to the Mitylenians to demand the fugitive of them, and they were preparing to give him up for a reward, I can't say with certainty how large, as the bargain wasn't completed, when the Chaimeans, hearing what the Mitylenians were about, sent a vessel to Lesbos and conveyed away Pactias to Chios. From hence it was that he was surrendered. The Chians dragged him from the temple of Athena Polyucus and gave him up to the Persians on condition of receiving the district of Atarneus, a tract of Mysia opposite to Lesbos, as the price of the surrender. Thus did Pactias fall into the hands of his pursuers, who kept a strict watch upon him that they might be able to produce him before Cyrus. For a long time afterwards, none of the Chians would use the barley of Atarneus to place on the heads of victims or make sacrificial cakes of the corn grown there, but the whole produce of the land was excluded from all their temples. Meanwhile, Mazares, after he had recovered Bactias from the Chians, made war upon those who had taken part in the attack upon Tabalus, and in the first place took Priene and sold the inhabitants for slaves, after which he overran the whole plain of the Meander and the district of Magnesia, both of which he gave up for pillage to the soldiery. He then suddenly sickened and died. Upon his death, Harpagus was sent down to the coast to succeed to his command. He also was of the race of the Medes, being the man whom the Median king Astyages feasted at the unholy banquet, and who lent his aid to place Cyrus upon the throne. Appointed by Cyrus to conduct the war in these parts, he entered Ionia and took the cities by means of mounds. Forcing the enemy to shut themselves up within their defences, he heaped mounds of earth against their walls, and thus carried the towns. Phocia was the city against which he directed his first attack. Now the Phocians were the first of the Greeks who performed long voyages, and it was they who made the Greeks acquainted with the Adriatic and with Tyrrhenia, with Iberia, and the city of Tartessus. The vessel which they used in their voyages was not the round-built merchant ship, but the long Penteconta. On their arrival at Tartessus, the king of the country, whose name was Arganthonius, took a liking to them. This monarch reigned over the Tartessians for 8 years, and lived to be 120 years old. He regarded the Phocians with so much favour as at first to beg them to quit Ionia and settle in whatever part of his country they liked. Afterwards, finding that he couldn't prevail upon them to agree to this, and hearing that the Mede was growing great in their neighbourhood, he gave them money to build a wall about their town, and certainly he must have given it with a bountiful hand, for the town is many furlongs in circuit, and the wall is built entirely of great blocks of stone skilfully fitted together. The wall, then, was built by his aid. Harpagus, having advanced against the Phocians with his army, laid siege to their city, first, however, offering them terms. It would content him, he said, if the Phocians would agree to throw down one of their battlements and dedicate one dwelling house to the king. The Phocians, sorely vexed at the thought of becoming slaves, asked a single day to deliberate on the answer they should return, and besought Harpagus during that day to draw off his forces from the walls. Harpagus replied that he understood well enough what they were about to do, but nevertheless he would grant their request. Accordingly, the troops were withdrawn, and the Phocians forthwith took advantage of their absence to launch their Pentacontas, and put on board their wives and children, their household goods, and even the images of their gods, with all the votive offerings from the fanes, except the paintings and the works in stone or brass which were left behind. With the rest they embarked, and putting to sea, set sail for Chios. The Persians, on their return, took possession of an empty town. Arrived at Chios, the Phocians made offers for the purchase of the islands called the Oinousoi, but the Chians refused to part with them, fearing lest the Phocians should establish a factory there and exclude their merchants from the commerce of those seas. On their refusal, the Phocians, as Arganthonius was now dead, made up their minds to sail to Chirinus, Corsica, where 20 years before, following the direction of an oracle, they had founded a city which was called Alalia. Before they set out, however, on this voyage, they sailed once more to Phocia, and surprising the Persian troops appointed by Harpagus to garrison the town, put them all to the sword. After this, they laid the heaviest curses on the man who should draw back and forsake the armament, and having dropped a heavy mass of iron into the sea, swore never to return to Phocia until that mass reappeared upon the surface. Nevertheless, as they were preparing to depart for Chirinus, more than half of their number were seized with such sadness and so great a longing to see once more their city and their ancient homes, that they broke the oath by which they had bound themselves and sailed back to Phocea. The rest of the Phoceans, who kept their oath, proceeded without stopping upon their voyage, and when they came to Cyrenus, established themselves, along with the earlier settlers, at Alalia, and built temples in the place. For 5 years they annoyed their neighbours by plundering and pillaging on all sides, until at length the Carthaginians and Tyrrhenians leagued against them, and sent each a fleet of 60 ships to attack the town. The Phoceans, on their part, manned all their vessels, 60 in number, and met their enemy on the Sardinian Sea. In the engagement which followed, the Phoceans were victorious, but their success was only a sort of Cadmean victory. They lost 40 ships in the battle, and 20 which remained came out of the engagement with beaks so bent and blunted as to be no longer serviceable. The Phoceans therefore sailed back again to Alalia, and, taking their wives and children on board, with such portion of their goods and chattels as the vessels could bear, made adieu to Cyrenus and sailed to Rhegium. The Carthaginians and Tyrrhenians, who'd got into their hands many more than the Phoceans from among the crews of the 40 vessels that were destroyed, landed their captives on the coast after the fight and stoned them all to death. Afterwards, when sheep or oxen or even men of the district of Agila passed by the spot where the murdered Phoceans lay, their bodies became distorted, and they were seized with palsy, or they lost the use of some of their limbs. On this, the people of Agila sent to Delphi to ask the oracle how they might expiate their sin. The answer of the Pythoness required them to institute the custom, which they still observe, of honouring the dead Phoceans with magnificent funeral rites and solemn games, both gymnic and equestrian. Such, then, was the fate that befell the Phocean prisoners. The other Phoceans, who had fled to Rhegium, became, after a while, the founders of the city called Vela, in the district of Onotria. This city they colonized upon the showing of a man of Posidonia, who suggested that the oracle had not meant to bid them set up a town in Cyrenus, the island, but set up the worship of Cyrenus the hero. Thus fared it with the men of the city of Phocea in Ionia. They of Teos did and suffered almost the same, for they too, when Harpagus had raised his mound to the height of their defences, took ship, one and all, and sailing across the sea to Thrace, founded there the city of Abdera. The city was one which Timesius of Cladsomene had previously tried to colonize, but without any lasting success, for he was expelled by the Thracians. Still, the Teans of Abdera worship him to this day as a hero. Of all the Ionians, these two states alone, rather than submit to slavery, forsook their fatherland. The others, I except Miletus, resisted Harpagus no less bravely than those who fled their country, and performed many feats of arms, each fighting in their own defence. But one after another they suffered defeat. The cities were taken, and the inhabitants submitted, remaining in their respective countries and obeying the behests of their new lords. Miletus, as I have already mentioned, had made terms with Cyrus, and so continued at peace. Thus was continental Ionia once more reduced to servitude. And when the Ionians of the islands saw their brethren upon the mainland subjugated, they also, dreading the like, gave themselves up to Cyrus. It was while the Ionians were in this distress, but still amid it all held their meetings as of old at the Panionium, that Bias of Priene, who was present at the festival, recommended, as I'm informed, a project of the very highest wisdom, which would, had it been embraced, have enabled the Ionians to become the happiest and most flourishing of the Greeks. He exhorted them to join in one body, set sail for Sardinia, and there found a single Pan-Ionic city. So they would escape from slavery and rise to great fortune, being masters of the largest island in the world, exercising dominion even beyond its bounds, whereas if they stayed in Ionia, he saw no prospect of their ever recovering their lost freedom. Such was the counsel which Bias gave the Ionians in their affliction. Before their misfortunes began, Thales, a man of Miletus, of Phoenician descent, had recommended a different plan. He counseled them to establish a single seat of government and pointed out Teos as the fittest place for it. For that, he said, was the centre of Ionia. Their other cities might still continue to enjoy their own laws, just as if they were independent states. This also was good advice. After conquering the Ionians, Harpagus proceeded to attack the Carians, the Cornians, and the Lycians. The Ionians and Aeolians were forced to serve in his army. Now of the above nations, the Carians were a race who came into the mainland from the islands. In ancient times they were subjects to King Minos, and went by the name of Leleges, dwelling among the isles, and, so far as I've been able to push my inquiries, never liable to give tribute to any man. They served on board the ships of King Minos whenever he required, and thus, as he was a great conqueror and prospered in his wars, the Carians were in his day the most famous by far of all the nations of the earth. They likewise were the inventors of three things, the use of which was borrowed from them by the Greeks. They were the first to fasten crests on helmets and to put devices on shields, and they also invented handles for shields. In the earlier time, shields were without handles, and their wearers managed them by the aid of a leathern thong, by which they were slung round the neck and left shoulder. Long after the time of Minos, the Carians were driven from the islands by the Ionians and Dorians, and so settled upon the mainland. The above is the account which the Cretans give of the Carians. The Carians themselves say very differently. They maintain that they are the aboriginal inhabitants of the part of the mainland where they now dwell, and never had any other name than that which they still bear. And in proof of this, they show an ancient temple of Carian Jove in the country of the Milesians, in which the Mysians and Lydians have the right of worshipping as brother races of the Carians. For Ledus and Mysus, they say, were brothers of Car. These nations therefore have the aforesaid right, but such as are of a different race, even though they've come to use the Carian tongue, are excluded from this temple. The Cornians, in my judgment, are aboriginals, but by their own account they came from Crete. In their language either they have approximated to the Carians or the Carians to them. On this point I can't speak with certainty. In their customs, however, they differ greatly from the Carians, and not only so, but from all other men. They think it a most honourable practice for friends or persons of the same age, whether they be men, women, or children, to meet together in large companies for the purpose of drinking wine. Again, on one occasion they determined that they would no longer make use of the foreign temples which had been long established among them, but would worship their own old ancestral gods alone. Then their whole youth took arms, and striking the air with their spears, marched to the Calindic frontier, declaring that they were driving out the foreign gods. The Lycians are in good truth anciently from Crete, which island in former days was wholly peopled with barbarians. A quarrel arising there between the two sons of Europa, Sarpedon and Minos, as to which of them should be king, Minos, whose party prevailed, drove Sarpedon and his followers into banishment. The exiles sailed to Asia and landed on the Melian territory. Meleus was the ancient name of the country now inhabited by the Lycians. The Melii of the present day were, in those times, called Solimi. So long as Sarpedon reigned, his followers kept the name which they had brought with them from Crete and were called Termili, as the Lycians still are by those who live in their neighbourhood. But after Lycus, the son of Pandion, banished from Athens by his brother Aegeus, had found a refuge with Sarpedon in the country of those Termili, they came in course of time to be called from him Lycians. Their customs are partly Cretan, partly Carian. They have, however, one singular custom in which they differ from every other nation in the world. They take the mother's and not the father's name. Ask a Lycian who he is, and he answers by giving his own name, that of his mother, and so on in the female line. Moreover, if a free woman marry a man who is a slave, their children are full citizens, But if a free man marry a foreign woman or live with a concubine, even though he be the first person in the state, the children forfeit all the rights of citizenship. Of these nations, the Carians submitted to Harpagus without performing any brilliant exploits. Nor did the Greeks who dwelt in Caria behave with any greater gallantry. Among them were the Cnidians, colonists from Lacedaemon, who occupy a district facing the sea, which is called Triopium. This region adjoins upon the Bybassian Chersonese, and except a very small space is surrounded by the sea, being bounded on the north by the Ceramic Gulf, and on the south by the channel towards the islands of Syme and Rhodes. While Harpagus was engaged in the conquest of Ionia, the Cnidians, wishing to make their country an island, attempted to cut through this narrow neck of land, which was no more than 5 furlongs across from sea to sea. Their whole territory lay inside the isthmus, for where Cnidia ends towards the mainland, the isthmus begins, which they were now seeking to cut through. The work had been commenced, and many hands were employed upon it, when it was observed that there seemed to be something unusual and unnatural in the number of wounds that the workmen received, especially about their eyes, from the splintering of the rock. The Cnidians, therefore, sent to Delphi to inquire what it was that hindered their efforts, and received, according to their own account, the following answer from the oracle. Fence not the isthmus off, nor dig it through. Jove would have made an island had he wished. So the Cnidians ceased digging, and when Harpagus advanced with his army, they gave themselves up to him without striking a blow. Above Halicarnassus, and further from the coast, were the Pedasians. With these people, when any evil is about to befall either themselves or their neighbours, the priestess of Athena grows an ample beard. 3 times has this marvel happened. They alone of all the dwellers of Caria resisted Harpagus for a while and gave him much trouble, maintaining themselves in a certain mountain called Leda, which they had fortified, but in course of time they also were forced to submit. When Harpagus, after these successes, led his forces into the Xanthian plain, the Lycians of Xanthus went out to meet him in the field. Though but a small band against a numerous host, they engaged in battle and performed many glorious exploits. Overpowered at last and forced within their walls, they collected into the citadel their wives and children, all their treasures and their slaves, and having so done, fired the building and burnt it to the ground. After this, they bound themselves together by dreadful oaths, and sallying forth against the enemy, died sword in hand, not one escaping. Those Lycians who now claim to be Xanthians are foreign immigrants, except 80 families who happened to be absent from the country and so survived the others. Thus was Xanthus taken by Harpagus, and Cornus fell in like manner into his hands, for the Cornians, in the main, followed the example of the Lycians. While the lower parts of Asia were in this way brought under by Harpagus, Cyrus in person subjected the upper regions, conquering every nation and not suffering one to escape. Of these conquests I shall pass by the greater portion and give an account of those only which gave him the most trouble and are the worthiest of mention. When he'd brought all the rest of the continent under his sway, he made war on the Assyrians. Assyria possesses a vast number of great cities, whereof the most renowned and strongest at this time was Babylon, whither, after the fall of Nineveh, the seat of government had been removed. The following is a description of the place. The city stands on a broad plain and is an exact square, 120 furlongs in length each way, so that the entire circuit is 480 furlongs. While such is its size, in magnificence there is no other city which approaches to it. It's surrounded, in the first place, by a broad and deep moat, full of water, behind which rises a wall 50 royal cubits in width and 200 in height. The royal cubit is longer by 3 fingers' breadth than the common cubit. And here I may not omit to tell the use to which the mould dug out of the great moat was turned, nor the manner wherein the wall was wrought. As fast as they dug the moat, the soil which they got from the cutting was made into bricks, and when a sufficient number were completed, they baked the bricks in kilns. Then they set to building and began with bricking the borders of the moat, after which they proceeded to construct the wall itself, using throughout for their cement hot bitumen, and interposing a layer of wattled reeds at every 30th course of the bricks. On the top, along the edges of the wall, they constructed buildings of a single chamber facing one another, leaving between them room for a 4-horse chariot to turn. In the circuit of the wall are 100 gates, all of brass, with brazen lintels and side posts. The bitumen used in the work was brought to Babylon from the Is, a small stream which flows into the Euphrates at the point where the city of the same name stands, 8 days' journey from Babylon. Lumps of bitumen are found in great abundance in this river. The city is divided into 2 portions by the river which runs through the midst of it. This river is the Euphrates, a broad, deep, swift stream which rises in Armenia and empties itself into the Erythraean Sea. The city wall is brought down on both sides to the edge of the stream. Thence, from the corners of the wall, there is carried along each bank of the river a fence of burnt bricks. The houses are mostly 3 and 4 stories high. The streets all run in straight lines, not only those parallel to the river, but also the cross streets which lead down to the waterside. At the river end of these cross streets are low gates in the fence that skirts the stream, which are, like the great gates in the outer wall, of brass and open on the water. The outer wall is the main defence of the city. There is, however, a second inner wall of less thickness than the first, but very little inferior to it in strength. The centre of each division of the town was occupied by a fortress. In the one stood the palace of the kings, surrounded by a wall of great strength and size. In the other was the sacred precinct of Zeus, Bel, a square enclosure 2 furlongs each way with gates of solid brass, which was also remaining in my time. In the middle of the precinct there was a tower of solid masonry, 1 furlong in length and breadth, upon which was raised a 2nd tower, and on that 1/3, and so on, up to 8. The ascent to the top is on the outside by a path which winds round all the towers. When one is about halfway up, one finds a resting place and seats where persons are wont to sit some time on their way to the summit. On the topmost tower there's a spacious temple, and inside the temple stands a couch of unusual size, richly adorned, with a golden table by its side. There's no statue of any kind set up in the place, nor is the chamber occupied of nights by anyone but a single native woman, who, as the Chaldeans, the priests of this god, affirm, is chosen for himself by the deity out of all the women of the land. They also declare, but I for my part do not credit it, that the god comes down in person into this chamber and sleeps upon the couch. This is like the story told by the Egyptians of what takes place in their city of Thebes, where a woman always passes the night in the temple of the Theban Zeus. In each case, the woman is said to be debarred all intercourse with men. It's also like the custom of Patara in Lycia, where the priestess who delivers the oracles during the time that she's so employed, for at Patara there isn't always an oracle, is shut up in the temple every night. Below, in the same precinct, there's a 2nd temple in which is a sitting figure of Zeus, all of gold. Before the figure stands a large golden table, and the throne whereon it sits and the base on which the throne is placed are likewise of gold. The Chaldeans told me that all the gold together was 800 talents weight. Outside the temple are two altars, one of solid gold, on which it's only lawful to offer sucklings, the other a common altar, but of great size, on which the full-grown animals are sacrificed. It's also on the great altar that the Chaldeans burn the frankincense, which is offered to the amount of 1,000 talents weight every year at the festival of the god. In the time of Cyrus, there was likewise in this temple a figure of a man, 12 cubits high, entirely of solid gold. I myself didn't see this figure, but I relate what the Chaldeans report concerning it. Darius, the son of Hystaspes, plotted to carry the statue off, but hadn't the hardihood to lay his hands upon it. Xerxes, however, the son of Darius, killed the priest who forbade him to move the statue and took it away. Besides the ornaments which I've mentioned, there are a large number of private offerings in this holy precinct. Many sovereigns have ruled over this city of Babylon and lent their aid to the building of its walls and the adornment of its temples, of whom I shall make mention in my Assyrian history. Among them, two were women. Of these, the earlier, called Semiramis, held the throne 5 generations before the later princess. She raised certain embankments, well worthy of inspection, in the plain near Babylon to control the river, which till then used to overflow and flood the whole country round about. The later of the two queens, whose name was Nitocris, a wiser princess than her predecessor, not only left behind her as memorials of her occupancy of the throne the works which I shall presently describe, but also, observing the great power and restless enterprise of the Medes, who had taken so large a number of cities, and among them Nineveh, and expecting to be attacked in her turn, made all possible exertions to increase the defences of her empire. And first, whereas the river Euphrates, which traverses the city, ran formerly with a straight course to Babylon, she, by certain excavations which she made, at some distance up the stream, rendered it so winding that it comes 3 several times in sight of the same village, a village in Assyria, which is called Arderica. And to this day they who would go from our sea to Babylon, on descending to the river, touch 3 times and on 3 different days at this very place. She also made an embankment along each side of the Euphrates, wonderful both for breadth and height, and dug a basin for a lake a great way above Babylon, close alongside of the stream, which was sunk everywhere to the point where they came to water, and was of such breadth that the whole circuit measured 420 furlongs. The soil dug out of this basin was made use of in the embankments along the waterside. When the excavation was finished, she had stones brought and bordered with them the entire margin of the reservoir. These 2 things were done, the river made to wind and the lake excavated, that the stream might be slacker by reason of the number of curves, and the voyage be rendered circuitous, and that at the end of the voyage it might be necessary to skirt the lake and so make a long round. All these works were on that side of Babylon where the passes lay, and the roads into Media were the straightest, and the aim of the queen in making them was to prevent the Medes from holding intercourse with the Babylonians, and so to keep them in ignorance of her affairs. While the soil from the excavation was being thus used for the defence of the city, Nitocris engaged also in another undertaking, a mere bywork compared with those we've already mentioned. The city, as I said, was divided by the river into 2 distinct portions. Under the former kings, if a man wanted to pass from one of these divisions to the other, he had to cross in a boat, which must, it seems to me, have been very troublesome. Accordingly, while she was digging the lake, Nitocris bethought herself of turning it to a use which should at once remove this inconvenience and enable her to leave another monument of her reign over Babylon. She gave orders for the hewing of immense blocks of stone, and when they were ready and the basin was excavated, she turned the entire stream of the Euphrates into the cutting, and thus for a time, while the basin was filling, the natural channel of the river was left dry. Forthwith she set to work, and in the first place lined the banks of the stream within the city with quays of burnt brick, and also bricked the landing places opposite the river gates, adopting throughout the same fashion of brickwork which had been used in the town wall. After which, with the materials which had been prepared, she built, as near the middle of the town as possible, a stone bridge, the blocks whereof were bound together with iron and lead. In the daytime, square wooden platforms were laid along from pier to pier, on which the inhabitants crossed the stream. But at night they were withdrawn, to prevent people passing from side to side in the dark, to commit robberies. When the river had filled the cutting, and the bridge was finished, the Euphrates was turned back again into its ancient bed, and thus the basin, transformed suddenly into a lake, was seen to answer the purpose for which it was made, and the inhabitants, by help of the basin, obtained the advantage of a bridge. It was this same princess by whom a remarkable deception was planned. She had her tomb constructed in the upper part of one of the principal gateways of the city, high above the heads of the passers-by, with this inscription cut upon it: "If there be one among my successors on the throne of Babylon who is in want of treasure, let him open my tomb and take as much as he chooses. Not, however, unless he be truly in want, for it will not be for his good." This tomb continued untouched until Darius came to the kingdom. To him it seemed a monstrous thing that he should be unable to use one of the gates of the town, and that a sum of money should be lying idle, and moreover inviting his grasp, and he not seize upon it. Now he couldn't use the gate, because as he drove through, the dead body would have been over his head. Accordingly he opened the tomb, but instead of money found only the dead body, and a writing which said, "Hadst thou not been insatiate of pelf, and careless how thou gottest it, thou wouldst not have broken open the sepulchres of the dead." The expedition of Cyrus was undertaken against the son of this princess, who bore the same name as his father, Lebanitus, and was king of the Assyrians. The great king, when he goes to the wars, is always supplied with provisions carefully prepared at home, and with cattle of his own. Water, too, from the river Coaspes, which flows by Susa, is taken with him for his drink, as that's the only water which the kings of Persia taste. Wherever he travels, he's attended by a number of four-wheeled cars drawn by mules, in which the Coaspes water, ready boiled for use and stored in flagons of silver, is moved with him from place to place. Cyrus, on his way to Babylon, came to the banks of the Gindes, a stream which, rising in the Matinean mountains, runs through the country of the Dardanians and empties itself into the river Tigris. The Tigris, after receiving the Gindes, flows on by the city of Opis and discharges its waters into the Erythraean Sea. When Cyrus reached this stream, which could only be passed in boats, one of the sacred white horses accompanying his march, full of spirit and high mettle, walked into the water and tried to cross by himself. But the current seized him, swept him along with it, and drowned him in its depths. Cyrus, enraged at the insolence of the river, threatened so to break its strength that in future even women should cross it easily without wetting their knees. Accordingly, he put off for a time his attack on Babylon, and dividing his army into two parts, he marked out by ropes 180 trenches on each side of the Gindes, leading off from it in all directions, and setting his army to dig, some on one side of the river, some on the other, he accomplished his threat by aid of so great a number of hands, but not without losing thereby the whole summer season. Having, however, thus wreaked his vengeance on the Gindes by dispersing it through 360 channels, Cyrus, with the first approach of the ensuing spring, marched forward against Babylon. The Babylonians, encamped without their walls, awaited his coming. A battle was fought at a short distance from the city, in which the Babylonians were defeated by the Persian king, whereupon they withdrew within their defences. Here they shut themselves up, and made light of his siege, having laid in a store of provisions for many years in preparation against this attack. For when they saw Cyrus conquering nation after nation, they were convinced that he would never stop, and that their turn would come at last. Cyrus was now reduced to great perplexity, as time went on and he made no progress against the place. In his distress, either someone made the suggestion to him, or he bethought himself of a plan, which he proceeded to put in execution. He placed a portion of his army at the point where the river enters the city, and another body at the back of the place where it issues forth, with orders to march into the town by the bed of the stream as soon as the water became shallow enough. He then himself drew off with the unwarlike portion of his host, and made for the place where Nitocris dug the basin for the river, where he did exactly what she had done formerly. He turned the Euphrates by a canal into the basin, which was then a marsh, on which the river sank to such an extent that the natural bed of the stream became fordable. Hereupon, the Persians, who had been left for the purpose at Babylon by the riverside, entered the stream, which had now sunk so as to reach about midway up a man's thigh, and thus got into the town. Had the Babylonians been apprised of what Cyrus was about, or had they noticed their danger, they would never have allowed the Persians to enter the city, but would have destroyed them utterly, for they would have made fast all the steel gates which gave upon the river, and mounting upon the walls along both sides of the stream, would so have caught the enemy, as it were, in a trap. But as it was, the Persians came upon them by surprise, and so took the city. Owing to the vast size of the place, the inhabitants of the central parts, as the residents of Babylon declare, long after the outer portions of the town were taken, knew nothing of what had chanced, but as they were engaged in a festival, continued dancing and revelling until they learnt the capture, but too certainly. Such, then, were the circumstances of the first taking of Babylon. Among many proofs which I shall bring forward of the power and resources of the Babylonians, the following is of special account. The whole country under the dominion of the Persians, besides paying a fixed tribute, is parcelled out into divisions which have to supply food to the great king and his army during different portions of the year. Now, out of the 12 months which go to a year, the district of Babylon furnishes food during 4, the other regions of Asia during 8, by which it appears that Assyria, in respect of resources, is 1/3 of the whole of Asia. Of all the Persian governments, or satrapies, as they are called by the natives, this is by far the best. When Tritantechmes, son of Artabazus, held it of the king, it brought him in an artaba of silver every day. The artaba is a Persian measure, and holds 3 koinexes more than the medimnus of the Athenians. He also had, belonging to his own private stud, besides war horses, 800 stallions, and 16,000 mares, 20 to each stallion. Besides which, he kept so great a number of Indian hounds that 4 large villages of the plain were exempted from all other charges on condition of finding them in food. But little rain falls in Assyria, enough, however, to make the corn begin to sprout, after which the plant is nourished and the ears formed by means of irrigation from the river. For the river doesn't, as in Egypt, overflow the cornlands of its own accord, but is spread over them by the hand or by the help of engines. The whole of Babylonia is, like Egypt, intersected with canals. The largest of them all, which runs toward the winter sun and is impassable except in boats, is carried from the Euphrates into another stream called the Tigris, the river upon which the town of Nineveh formerly stood. Of all the countries that we know, there is none which is so fruitful in grain. It makes no pretension indeed of growing the fig, the olive, the vine, or any other tree of the kind, but in grain it's so fruitful as to yield commonly 200-fold, and when the production is the greatest, even 300-fold. The blade of the wheat plant and barley plant is often 4 fingers in breadth. As for the millet and the sesame, I shall not say to what height they grow, though within my own knowledge, for I am not ignorant, that what I have already written concerning the fruitfulness of Babylonia must seem incredible to those who have never visited the country. The only oil they use is made from the sesame plant. Palm trees grow in great numbers over the whole of the flat country, mostly of the kind which bears fruit, and this fruit supplies them with bread, wine, and honey. They are cultivated like the fig trees in all respects, among others in this. The natives tie the fruit of the male palms, as they are called by the Greeks, to the branches of the date-bearing palm, to let the gall fly enter the dates and ripen them, and to prevent the fruit from falling off. The male palms, like the wild fig trees, have usually the gall fly in their fruit. But that which surprises me most in the land, after the city itself, I will now proceed to mention. The boats which come down the river to Babylon are circular and made of skins. The frames, which are of willow, are cut in the country of the Armenians above Assyria, and on these, which serve for hulls, a covering of skins is stretched outside, and thus the boats are made, without either stem or stern, quite round, like a shield. They are then entirely filled with straw, and their cargo is put on board, after which they are suffered to float down the stream. Their chief freight is wine, stored in casks, made of the wood of the palm tree. They are managed by 2 men, who stand upright in them, each plying an oar, one pulling and the other pushing. The boats are of various sizes, some larger, some smaller. The biggest reach as high as 5,000 talents burthen. Each vessel has a live ass on board. Those of larger size have more than one. When they reach Babylon, the cargo is landed and offered for sale, after which the men break up their boats, sell the straw and the frames, and loading their asses with the skins, set off on their way back to Armenia. The current is too strong to allow a boat to return upstream, for which reason they make their boats of skins rather than wood. On their return to Armenia, they build fresh boats for the next voyage. The dress of the Babylonians is a linen tunic reaching to the feet, and above it another tunic made in wool, besides which they have a short white cloak thrown round them, and shoes of a peculiar fashion, not unlike those worn by the Boeotians. They have long hair, wear turbans on their heads, and anoint their whole body with perfumes. Each one carries a seal and a walking stick, carved at the top into the form of an apple, a rose, a lily, an eagle, or something similar, for it's not their habit to use a stick without an ornament. Of their customs, whereof I shall now proceed to give an account, the following, which I understand belongs to them in common with the Illyrian tribe of the Eneti, is the wisest, in my judgment. Once a year in each village, the maidens of age to marry were collected all together into one place, while the men stood around them in a circle. Then a herald called up the damsels one by one and offered them for sale. He began with the most beautiful. When she was sold for no small sum of money, he offered for sale the one who came next to her in beauty. All of them were sold to be wives. The richest of the Babylonians who wished to wed bid against each other for the loveliest maidens, while the humbler wife-seekers, who were indifferent about beauty, took the more homely damsels with marriage portions. For the custom was that when the herald had gone through the whole number of the beautiful damsels, he should then call up the ugliest, a cripple, if there chanced to be one, and offer her to the men, asking who would agree to take her with the smallest marriage portion. And the man who offered to take the smallest sum had her assigned to him. The marriage portions were furnished by the money paid for the beautiful damsels, and thus the fairer maidens portioned out the uglier. No one was allowed to give his daughter in marriage to the man of his choice, nor might any one carry away the damsel whom he had purchased without finding bail really and truly to make her his wife. If, however, it turned out that they didn't agree, the money might be paid back. All who liked might come even from distant villages and bid for the women. This was the best of all their customs, but it has now fallen into disuse. They've lately hit upon a very different plan to save their maidens from violence and prevent their being torn from them and carried to distant cities, which is to bring up their daughters to be courtesans. This is now done by all the poorer of the common people, who since the conquest have been maltreated by their lords and have had ruin brought upon their families. The following custom seems to me the wisest of their institutions next to the one lately praised. They have no physicians, but when a man is ill, they lay him in the public square, and the passers-by come up to him, and if they have ever had his disease themselves, or have known anyone who has suffered from it, they give him advice, recommending him to do whatever they found good in their own case, or in the case known to them. And no one is allowed to pass the sick man in silence without asking him what his ailment is. They bury their dead in honey, and have funeral lamentations, like the Egyptians. When a Babylonian has consorted with his wife, he sits down before a censer of burning incense, and the woman sits opposite to him. At dawn of day they wash, for till they are washed, they will not touch any of their common vessels. This practice is observed also by the Arabians. The Babylonians have one most shameful custom. Every woman born in the country must once in her life go and sit down in the precinct of Aphrodite, and there consort with a stranger. Many of the wealthier sort, who are too proud to mix with the others, drive in covered carriages to the precinct, followed by a goodly train of attendants, and there take their station. But the larger number seat themselves within the holy enclosure with wreaths of string about their heads. And here there's always a great crowd, some coming and others going. Lines of cord mark out paths in all directions among the women, and the strangers pass along them to make their choice. A woman who has once taken her seat is not allowed to return home till one of the strangers throws a silver coin into her lap and takes her with him beyond the holy ground. When he throws the coin, he says these words, "The goddess Melita prosper thee." Aphrodite is called Melita by the Assyrians. The silver coin may be of any size. It cannot be refused, for that's forbidden by the law, since once thrown, it's sacred. The woman goes with the first man who throws her money, and rejects no one. When she's gone with him, and so satisfied the goddess, she returns home, and from that time forth no gift, however great, will prevail with her. Some of the women, as are tall and beautiful, are soon released, but others who are ugly have to stay a long time before they can fulfil the law. Some have waited 3 or 4 years in the precinct. A custom very much like this is found also in certain parts of the island of Cyprus. Such are the customs of the Babylonians generally. There are likewise 3 tribes among them who eat nothing but fish. These are caught and dried in the sun, after which they're brayed in a mortar and strained through a linen sieve. Some prefer to make cakes of this material, while others bake it into a kind of bread. When Cyrus had achieved the conquest of the Babylonians, he conceived the desire of bringing the Massagetae under his dominion. Now, the Massagetae are said to be a great and warlike nation, dwelling eastward toward the rising of the sun, beyond the river Araxes, and opposite the Isidonians. By many, they're regarded as a Scythian race. As for the Araxes, it is, according to some accounts, larger, according to others, smaller than the Ister, the Danube. It has islands in it, many of which are said to be equal in size to Lesbos. The men who inhabit them feed during the summer on roots of all kinds, which they dig out of the ground, while they store up the fruits, which they gather from the trees, at the fitting season, to serve them as food in the winter time. Besides the trees, whose fruit they gather for this purpose, they've also a tree which bears the strangest produce. When they're met together in companies, they throw some of it upon the fire round which they're sitting, and presently, by the mere smell of the fumes which it gives out in burning, they grow drunk, as the Greeks do with wine. More of the fruit is then thrown on the fire, and their drunkenness increasing, they often jump up and begin to dance and sing. Such is the account which I've heard of this people. The river Araxes, like the Gindes, which Cyrus dispersed into 360 channels, has its source in the country of the Mataneans. It has 40 mouths, whereof all, except one, end in bogs and swamps. These bogs and swamps are said to be inhabited by a race of men who feed on raw fish and clothe themselves with the skins of seals. The other mouth of the river flows with a clear course into the Caspian Sea. The Caspian is a sea by itself, having no connection with any other. The sea frequented by the Greeks, that beyond the Pillars of Hercules, which is called the Atlantic, and also the Erythraean, are all one and the same sea. But the Caspian is a distinct sea, lying by itself in length 15 days' voyage with a rowboat, in breadth, at the broadest part, 8 days' voyage. Along its western shore runs the chain of the Caucasus, the most extensive and loftiest of all mountain ranges. Many and various are the tribes by which it's inhabited, most of whom live entirely on the wild fruits of the forest. In these forests, certain trees are said to grow, from the leaves of which, pounded and mixed with water, the inhabitants make a dye, wherewith they paint upon their clothes the figures of animals. And the figures, so impressed, never wash out, but last as though they had been inwoven in the cloth from the first, and wear as long as the garment. And these people couple in the open, they say, like animals in herds. On the west, then, as I've said, the Caspian Sea is bounded by the range of Caucasus. On the east, it's followed by a vast plain, stretching out interminably before the eye, the greater portion of which is possessed by those Massagetae, against whom Cyrus was now so anxious to make an expedition. Many strong motives weighed with him and urged him on, his birth especially, which seemed something more than human, and his good fortune in all his former wars, wherein he'd always found that against what country soever he turned his arms, it was impossible for that people to escape. At this time the Massagetae were ruled by a queen named Tomyris, who, at the death of her husband, the late king, had mounted the throne. To her Cyrus sent ambassadors with instructions to court her on his part, pretending that he wished to take her to wife. Tomyris, however, aware that it was her kingdom and not herself that he courted, forbade the men to approach. Cyrus, therefore, finding that he didn't advance his designs by this deceit, marched towards the Araxes, and openly displaying his hostile intentions, set to work to construct a bridge on which his army might cross the river, and began building towers upon the boats which were to be used in the passage. While the Persian leader was occupied in these labours, Tomyris sent a herald to him, who said, "King of the Medes, cease to press this enterprise, for thou canst not know if what thou art doing will be of real advantage to thee. Be content to rule in peace thy own kingdom, and bear to see us reign over the countries that are ours to govern. As, however, I know thou wilt not choose to hearken to this counsel, since there is nothing thou less desirest than peace and quietness, Come now, if thou art so mightily desirous of meeting the Massagetae in arms, leave thy useless toil of bridge-making. Let us retire 3 days' march from the river-bank, and do thou come across with thy soldiers. Or, if thou likest better to give us battle on thy side of the stream, retire thyself an equal distance. Cyrus, on this offer, called together the chiefs of the Persians and laid the matter before them, requesting them to advise him what he should do. All the votes were in favour of his letting Tomyris cross the stream and giving battle on Persian ground. But Croesus, the Lydian, who was present at the meeting of the chiefs, disapproved of this advice. He therefore rose and thus delivered his sentiments in opposition to it. O my king, I promised thee long since that as Jove had given me into thy hands, I would, to the best of my power, avert impending danger from thy house. Alas, my own sufferings, by their very bitterness, have taught me to be keen-sighted of dangers. If thou deemest thyself an immortal, and thine army an army of immortals, my counsel will doubtless be thrown away upon thee. But if thou feelest thyself to be a man, and a ruler of men, lay this first to heart, that there is a wheel on which the affairs of men revolve, and that its movement forbids the same man to be always fortunate. Now concerning the matter in hand, my judgment runs counter to the judgment of thy other counsellors. For if thou agreest to give the army entrance into thy country, consider what risk is run. Lose the battle, and therewith thy whole kingdom is lost. For assuredly the Massagetae, if they win the fight, will not return to their homes, but will push forward again. Or if thou gainest the battle, why then thou gainest far less than if thou wert to cross the stream, where thou mightest follow up thy victory. For against thy loss, if they defeat thee on thine own ground, must be set theirs in like case. Rout their army on the other side of the river, and thou mayest push at once into the heart of their country. Moreover, were it not disgrace intolerable for Cyrus, the son of Cambyses, to retire before and yield ground to a woman? My counsel, therefore, is that we cross the stream, and pushing forward as far as they shall fall back, then seek to get the better of them by stratagem. I'm told they're unacquainted with the good things on which the Persians live, and have never tasted the great delights of life. Let us then prepare a feast for them in our camp. Let sheep be slaughtered without stint, and the wine cups be filled full of noble liquor, and let all manner of dishes be prepared. Then, leaving behind us our worst troops, let us fall back towards the river. Unless I very much mistake, when they see the good fare set out, they will forget all else and fall too. Then it will remain for us to do our parts manfully. Cyrus, when the two plans were thus placed in contrast before him, changed his mind, and preferring the advice which Croesus had given, returned for answer to Tomyris that she should retire, and that he would cross the stream. She therefore retired, as she had engaged, and Cyrus, giving Croesus into the care of his son Cambyses, whom he had appointed to succeed him on the throne, with strict charge to pay him all respect and treat him well if the expedition failed of success, and sending them both back to Persia, crossed the river with his army. The first night after the passage, as he slept in the enemy's country, a vision appeared to him. He seemed to see in his sleep the eldest of the sons of Hystaspes, with wings upon his shoulders, shadowing with the one wing Asia, and Europe with the other. Now Hystaspes, the son of Arsames, was of the race of the Achaemenidae, and his eldest son, Darius, was at that time scarce 20 years old. Wherefore, not being of age to go to the wars, he had remained behind in Persia. When Cyrus woke from his sleep and turned the vision over in his mind, it seemed to him no light matter. He therefore sent for Hystaspes, and taking him aside, said, "Hystaspes, thy son is discovered to be plotting against me and my crown. I will tell thee how I know it so certainly. The gods watch over my safety and warn me beforehand of every danger. Now last night, as I lay in my bed, I saw in a vision the eldest of thy sons with wings upon his shoulders, shadowing with the one wing Asia and Europe with the other. From this it is certain, beyond all possible doubt, that he's engaged in some plot against me. Return thou then at once to Persia, and be sure, when I come back from conquering the Massagetae, to have thy son ready to produce before me, that I may examine him. Thus Cyrus spoke, in the belief that he was plotted against by Darius. But he missed the true meaning of the dream, which was sent by God to forewarn him that he was to die then and there, and that his kingdom was to fall at last to Darius. Hystaspes made answer to Cyrus in these words, Heaven forbid, sire, that there should be a Persian living who would plot against thee. If such an one there be, may a speedy death overtake him. Thou foundest the Persians a race of slaves, and thou hast made them free men. Thou foundest them subject to others. Thou hast made them lords of all. If a vision has announced that my son is practicing against thee, lo, I resign him into thy hands to deal with as thou wilt. Hystaspes, when he had thus answered, recrossed the Araxes and hastened back to Persia to keep a watch on his son Darius. Meanwhile, Cyrus, having advanced a day's march from the river, did as Croesus had advised him, and leaving the worthless portion of his army in the camp, drew off with his good troops towards the river. Soon afterwards, a detachment of the Massagetae, one-third of their entire army, led by Spargopices, son of the queen Tomyris, coming up, fell upon the body which had been left behind by Cyrus, and on their resistance put them to the sword. Then, seeing the banquet prepared, they sat down and began to feast. When they had eaten and drunk their fill, and were now sunk in sleep, the Persians under Cyrus arrived, slaughtered a great multitude, and made even a larger number prisoners. Among these last was Spargopices himself. When Tomyris heard what had befallen her son and her army, she sent a herald to Cyrus, who thus addressed the conqueror. Thou bloodthirsty Cyrus, pride not thyself on this poor success. It was the grape juice which, when ye drink it, makes you so mad, and as ye swallow it down, brings up to your lips such bold and wicked words. It was this poison wherewith thou didst ensnare my child, and so overcamest him, not in fair open fight. Now hearken what I advise, and be sure I advise thee for thy good. Restore my son to me, and get thee from the land unharmed, triumphant over a third part of the host of the Massagetae. Refuse, and I swear by the sun, the sovereign lord of the Massagetae, bloodthirsty as thou art, I will give thee thy fill of blood. To the words of this message, Cyrus paid no manner of regard. As for Spargopices, the son of the queen, when the wine went off and he saw the extent of his calamity, he made request to Cyrus to release him from his bonds. Then, when his prayer was granted and the fetters were taken from his limbs, as soon as his hands were free, he destroyed himself. Tomyris, when she found that Cyrus paid no heed to her advice, collected all the forces of her kingdom and gave him battle. Of all the combats in which the barbarians have engaged among themselves, I reckon this to have been the fiercest. The following, as I understand, was the manner of it. First, the two armies stood apart and shot their arrows at each other. Then, when their quivers were empty, they closed and fought hand to hand with lances and daggers. And thus they continued fighting for a length of time, neither choosing to give ground. At length the Massagetae prevailed. The greater part of the army of the Persians was destroyed, and Cyrus himself fell, after reigning 29 years. Search was made among the slain by order of the queen for the body of Cyrus, and when it was found, she took a skin, and filling it full of human blood, she dipped the head of Cyrus in the gore, saying as she thus insulted the corpse, I live and have conquered thee in fight, and yet by thee am I ruined, for thou tookest my son with guile. But thus I make good my threat, and give thee thy fill of blood. Of the many different accounts which are given of the death of Cyrus, this which I have followed appears to me most worthy of credit. In their dress and mode of living, the Massagetae resemble the Scythians. They fight both on horseback and on foot. Neither method is strange to them. They use bows and lances, but their favourite weapon is the battle axe. Their arms are all either of gold or brass. For their spear points and arrowheads, and for their battle axes, they make use of brass. For headgear, belts, and girdles, of gold. So too with the caparison of their horses, they give them breastplates of brass, but employ gold about the reins, the bit, and the cheekplates. They use neither iron nor silver, having none in their country, but they have brass and gold in abundance. The following are some of their customs. Each man has but one wife, yet all the wives are held in common. For this is a custom of the Massagetae, and not of the Scythians, as the Greeks wrongly say. For when a man of the Massagetae desires a woman, he hangs up his quiver in front of her wagon, and lies with her without fear. Human life does not come to its natural close with this people, but when a man grows very old, all his kinsfolk collect together and offer him up in sacrifice, offering at the same time some cattle also. After the sacrifice, they boil the flesh and feast on it, and those who thus end their days are reckoned the happiest. If a man dies of disease, they don't eat him, but bury him in the ground, bewailing his ill fortune that he didn't come to be sacrificed. They sow no grain, but live on their herds and on fish, of which there's great plenty in the Araxes. Milk is what they chiefly drink. The only god they worship is the sun, and to him they offer the horse in sacrifice, under the notion of giving to the swiftest of the gods the swiftest of all mortal creatures.